You are in for a great treat tonight. Yulin is a long-time friend. We started our first companies within a few years of one another. And I have always been fascinated by Yulin. You know, most entrepreneurs spend their lifetimes trying to convince investors about how much market share they're going to take from a competitor, how much, why their competitor isn't good. Yulin has never started a company where there was a competitor, okay? Other people, you know, go at this by inventing a product, okay? Yulin invents markets and industries, okay? They didn't exist before he came along. He started his career at Computer Motion, which you all know about, the invention of Aesop, the first FDA-cleared robotic tool. Everybody said, what? We used to go over this. I said he is constitutionally incapable of not being a visionary and leading things. Yulin went on after merging Intuitive Surgical with Computer Motion to start InTouch Health. It's now been recognized as one of the fastest growing healthcare and technology companies by the likes of the Inc. 500 and Deloitte 500. You see that here, okay? The number of awards, you know, Craig says my awards, Yulin is dripping in them, okay? And has earned every single one of them. He is also a TV star. He has appeared on the Today Show, CNN, and he's always so good at it. I mean, he makes Santa Barbara look really, really good. And the other thing is, he always brings cool toys. So, get ready for a fun evening, my friend Yulin.
Thank you, Kathy. I have to echo what Craig said in terms of Kathy being really a mentor to a lot of people in this community. She certainly shared lots of discussions with me over the years as well. And so it's really a pleasure and a privilege to be here today. And, kind of just getting to the topic here, I guess I didn't know there weren't any. I thought no competitors was a good thing. But then as I find out, you know, having no competitors means there's probably no market. And then you have to go long enough to make sure the market catches up with you. And then hopefully if that happens, then everything turns out well. And I think that fortunately did happen in surgical robots. And then I think in this area, which I've been working in for a dozen years now in terms of telemedicine, I think it's actually hitting that inflection point too, which is actually a pretty exciting thing. So I think what I was asked, what was advertised was me talking really about how the healthcare system is changing in general. And it is an area I'm pretty familiar with in terms of how healthcare reform is changing the entire healthcare system. And it's actually in the rapid change phase right now. So it's actually a very exciting place to be. Healthcare, typically a slow-moving area, is, I think, in a period of probably about as rapid a change as you can, on a systemic level, as has been certainly in my at least 30 years in career, and I think for longer than that. What I'm gonna do today is, my talk is structured into three pieces. The first piece is gonna be about some of the overall trends and dynamics which are impacting healthcare, so kind of at a macro level. The second phase is I'm gonna talk about what InTouch has done in this area of telemedicine and basically, you know, share with you some stories of how kind of remote care, remote presence is really maturing into something very real. And then the third phase is I'm gonna talk about where things are going from there. So those are kind of the three things which I'm gonna go through. And so just to start with, in terms of the trends and what's going on, this has been going on for now hundreds of years, but some of you probably know this, some of you may not, but it's pretty interesting to see that up until, you know, the 1900s, the average life expectancy was in the mid-30s. Okay, if you, you know, everybody knows Moore's law of doubling the compute power every 18 months. What people don't know, and it's never, someone should name it as a law, but for the last 150 years, life expectancy has been going up 1 year for every five calendar years. So that's great for us living longer, happier lives, but that by itself is the main driver to the big, huge societal problem that we face today. You know, Jeff Henley, the chairman of Oracle, a big resident of Santa Barbara here, has said to me, he says, this problem right here is perhaps the biggest problem the U.S. society, and I think a lot of societies around the world face. And that is that if you look up here, we're at about 17% of the GDP is spent on healthcare. This is the healthcare costs of the U.S. relative to the other countries. This is the per capita spending on healthcare. And this is the trend lines where we're projected to, by the end of this century, unless we bend the curve, we're going to spend 50% of our GDP on healthcare. Okay? But it's, you know, it's heavily influenced by that previous curve. It's because medical science has improved so much. I mean, why are we getting another year for every five calendar years? It's because medical science is improving. We're curing cancer, we cured heart disease, we obviously a long time ago invented antibiotics, sterility, all these things are making that curve go up to the right, but then the consequences of it is this. And the other thing, consequence of it, is medicine, as we are advancing, it's the complexity is unbelievable. In 1970, there were 20 different physician specialties. Today, four decades later, there are 150. There were about 200,000 journal articles published a year in 1970. Today, there's 800,000 journal articles published a year. So if you're a physician trying to keep up with your field, you can imagine that just becomes an unsustainable problem. And then the number of care providers we have, the people enrolling in medical school, is actually going down. So you got lesser people going in to a more complex field, subdivided across more specialties, and you've got an aging population. And in all of this, what's our job? Our job is to figure out how to produce high-quality care to everybody at a lower cost. So that's the problem, and that's the opportunity. And so this is where I think a lot of very exciting opportunities can come to bear. So, I mean, if you can figure some of these problems out, it's of significant benefit to society. And as a consequence, you should be able to do well as an entrepreneur. So telemedicine, which is the field that I've been working in for about a dozen years now, to put it in just a framework where it hopefully conveys the power of it, is, as I already mentioned, tremendous amount of advancement in medical science is happening. And then we all been hearing about all these terms of big data, putting analytical engines on top of big data sets with personalized medicine in order to improve the ability to deliver care to patients in the most appropriate way. But if you bring it down to where the rubber meets the road, you're ultimately got a clinician delivering care to patients. Now, if that is ultimately where care is delivered, you've got a bottleneck. You got a bottleneck, and that person can only deliver care to these number of patients. But what if you could open that up? What if you could enable this person equipped with all of that information, and perhaps it's cloud-based, to deliver care to all of these patients? That is a way of solving that problem. Quality, because you're equipping them with all the information. Access, because you're giving it to everybody. lowers cost because that person and all of that stuff is leveraged over a larger base of patients. And that's, I think, what the promise of telemedicine is. It's the right expertise at the right place to do the right thing at the right time. And so one way to think about, and this is a slide from a long time ago, so how do you do it? And, you know, what was it? Doc from Star Trek would be on the Enterprise, and there'd be some alien being who was sick, okay? And Doc would go in the transporter, and then boom, go over to the alien beam, and then take care of him, and then boom, right back to the Enterprise. So this is the concept of how we can actually use the internet combined with robotics-type technology to bring expertise over. And I'm going to ask my colleague to join me, okay, in order to do something to show kind of how it might really work, okay? So this, what we have done, you know, we don't have a transporter, and we do have the internet. We started in 2002 when actually the internet, the power of the internet was pretty unknown. And so could you actually beam a physician from one place to another to take care of a patient some other location? That was a very unknown kind of thing. Short, I want you to come on up. So what we had as a basis is we were going to use the internet to provide the backbone telecommunication infrastructure, and then we wanted to build a remote presence of the physician to be as enabling as possible for that physician. So this is one of our devices, and it's called RP Vita. And RP Vita is driving around, and Shrodan, who's my colleague, is actually showing how this can work. And so what she's doing is she's driving this device, which is to represent a physician at some other location. So one of the things that the physicians needs to be able to do with the device is to round. And you can kind of see how she can kind of move from like patient one to patient two to patient three to patient four, et cetera. It's using something called SLAM technology, simultaneous localization and mapping technology. And the SLAM technology, why don't you stop there? So the SLAM technology is actually mapping the actual environment and is actually able to move around people as it actually navigates through like an emergency room or something like that. So why don't you put a CT scan onto the face of the robot and then look toward the audience. And then what we also have is a sensor suite in the middle, which is using a combination of infrared cameras and infrared transceivers in order to avoid obstacles as it moves around. So one of the other things that we've got here is a number of devices which can connect into the system. This is actually a phone in order to have a private conversation, and especially if it's in a noisy environment. These are a bunch of ports so that you can actually plug in, say, an ultrasound, you can plug in an otoscope, you can plug in all kinds of different accessories. She actually pulled a CT scan, so say you're also the physician's using a PAC system, she's able to take a CT scan, project it to the face, so that the patient can you can actually coach the patient and or the local physician on what's going on. On this side, there's things like a stethoscope, so you can actually listen to heart and lung sounds and do especially things which are pretty subjective, like heart and lung sounds in terms of how the patient's doing. And so those are the kinds of things that we can do with these remote presence devices. So we are now deployed in about 1,200 hospitals around the country. And what's kind of unique to how we did this whole thing, and in fact, Klaus of AppFolio, who I think Craig said just announced that they filed for a public offering. Klaus was actually instrumental in helping us figure out how to do this. So we actually leveraged the local community in terms of how to architect this. But all of our whole network is actually under a common cloud architecture, such that from my iPhone right here, I can actually log into any of 1,200 hospitals, which is a pretty unheard of statement, that if I have an iPhone standing right here, I can actually log into and take care of patients in any hospital on this map. And that actually creates all kinds of very interesting opportunities in terms of, like, we have physicians, we have a doc who lives way out there in Montana, and he takes care of patients in about 50 of the hospitals over here. We have a doc who used to live in Georgia. She met a guy from Paris, married the guy, moved to Paris, and is still working in Georgia. We have a group of docs in here who are taking care of about 80 hospitals throughout here, and they don't actually take care of patients the whole time. They're oftentimes plugging gaps where the local hospital is unable to fulfill its resource needs. We have a group of docs here who actually have a system down in Haiti and are taking care of patients there. We have a group over here which is taking care of patients in Gabon, Africa. We just have a new set of docs in Canada who are doing ICU rounding in Kuwait. So these models, you know, that's never before been possible, thinking about those kind of models. So we developed this cloud, and it's turned out that, you know, people see the robot and they associate InTouch with the robot, but in fact the kind of the real backbone of the whole company is this cloud architecture we have, where it has all of these properties which allow me to do things like say to you, from this iPhone I can connect into 1,200 hospitals and help take care of patients. And so, you know, so we're in a bunch of systems now, and the number one application, I was talking to a young gentleman right before we started here, who's I think in the process of starting a company, and I told him that, you know, what you gotta do is you gotta find the high value beachhead application to get going in, okay? It took us a few years to find it for us, but we found it in stroke, okay? You know, the concept of getting a needed physician to a patient quickly, everyone buys into that concept, but how do you actualize it? How do you make it into an actual business model where the clinical and the financial models all align and people buy it, right? We found it in stroke. Stroke's a big problem, you know, third leading cause of death, first leading cause of disability, about 700,000 in the US alone. And only 2-4% of stroke patients are treated properly because they don't have access to a stroke neurologist quick enough. It's a time thing. And so that's why stroke fit well with us, because we could get that patient there, that physician there quickly to care of that patient. So we got going there. Today, we sit in over 30 different service lines. We do a lot of mental health. We do a lot of critical care. We do pediatrics. We do trauma. We do even organ donation. We do a whole bunch of different applications. We've done over 500,000 consults now. We do about 150,000 consults this year. And it's actually growing to become something which is kind of becoming more mainstream. Let me just give you an example of how that works. And if I click on this, yeah,
first look at what could be the future of medicine. Robots already roaming through hospitals and allowing doctors to diagnose patients and in some instances make life-saving decisions from miles away much faster when every second counts. We get our report tonight from CNBC's Julia Borstein.
To see Edith Long now, you'd never know she recently had a near-death experience. When she suffered a stroke, there was no specialist at the hospital that night to evaluate her. So a robot named RP Vita came to call, connecting a doctor 25 miles away.
The next thing I remember is the robot coming into the room and Dr. Lee introducing himself to me.
When neurologist Dr. Andrew Lee got the call at home, instead of getting in his car, he powered up his iPad and immediately examined Edith through the robot's monitor.
I did notice that she had profound weakness of her left arm and her left leg.
He ordered a clot-busting drug within minutes.
For every minute that's lost in someone who's suffering a stroke, 1.9 million brain cells could be possibly irreversibly damaged.
So Dr. Lee, if you were to evaluate a stroke patient through this robot, what would you do?
To assess for strength and coordination, I would have you raise both arms up as if you're holding a tray.
And take your left index finger and touch your nose.
So this would allow you to assess a patient without actually being in the room.
Absolutely.
There are 28 of these RP Vita robots in use so far. Doctors who use the technology say it's a game changer.
We are able to actually provide these services to some of the smaller community hospitals. There is a large cost savings and the ability to treat many more patients.
Thanks to the robot, Edith Long made a full recovery.
To be back to normal so fast brings tears to my eyes because I'm back to my normal life.
A high-tech house call rebooting medicine. Julia Borstein, NBC News.
So that's an example. We'll do probably about 75,000 strokes this year. And so it's an exciting thing where it's kind of starting to become mainstream. If you talk to some docs, they'll say telestroke has become the standard of care. And actually, what's interesting is that a telestroke physician is generally faster than an in-person physician. So I think when we got going, the idea was that a remote presence physician is as close as you can get to an in-person physician, but not quite as good. But the reality is it's switching now. It's I wasn't able to say that in front of an audience, and I know there's some physicians here. I wasn't able to say that a few years ago. It's starting to get to the point where I can say that and not have tomatoes thrown at me, where that it's possible that virtual care can become better than in-person care. So that's gonna be pretty interesting. So how does it work? You basically have, so this is an example of one of our networks, Thomas Jefferson University. They have 25 partner hospitals, and they use their subspecialist tier to provide coverage for all these outlying hospitals. They've actually increased their TPA delivery rate, which is a clot-busting drug that was mentioned in the video, substantially, which is a measure of improved clinical outcomes. And they've done a whole bunch of consults of over 3,000 in the first couple of years. Here's an aggregation of six of our hub-spoke systems. Thomas Jefferson's one, Wake Forest is another, Dignity, et cetera, et cetera. And then what we also these are the number of transfers which have happened in those systems from 2,200 to 3,300 consults were actually called upon. And then there are about 1,000 transfers based on the 3,300 consults. And so it turns out that there's about 30% of the patients are transferred to the main patient, to the big hospital, and 70% remain in the outlying hospital. And because of all of that, and it took us years to figure out, there's an alignment of economic gain and clinical gain. And I don't have enough time to go through all of that, but the bottom line is these transfers in here power the economics for the hub hospitals, and these not transferred here power the economics of the outlying spoke hospitals, because these guys, our procedures are done here as well. So as I mentioned, if you're a stroke neurologist sitting here And you would agree that the national average of TPA dosage is 3%, and getting up to 20%, you would say that's a very marked improvement. And so that's what's repeatedly done. Dignity, which is a big system here in California, I think, you know, you guys may have heard of, they own about 50 hospitals. They're one of our leading customers in terms of utilization. And as I was saying earlier, they're running all these service lines through telemedicine. So it's pretty interesting because, you know, stroke, I already talked about, neurology, ICU, but you can see like things like cardiology, pulmonology, endocrinology, skilled nursing care, home, disease, these are all new telemedicine programs that they have launched using a network that they've deployed with us. And here the utilizations of their different, some of their different service lines going up. Here's a different one, EEGs. So an EEG, it turns out it's, you know, an EEG is you put these probes on your head and they measure your brain waves, and actually they can tell if the patient's seizing even though it might visibly not be apparent. In other words, you can seize and you're not conscious, but nobody can tell you're seizing because you don't physically show those signs of it, but with an EEG read you can, and obviously seizing's bad. And so having an EEG read is very much considered something which they don't do because there was no way to do it before. And now using telemedicine, having EEG specialists read EEGs continually is a real improvement. So it's another example of where telemedicine can actually enable things which people don't even try to do because it wasn't possible to do before. Psychiatry, I think, anybody here who knows, like Melinda knows, in terms of like on the psych side, 10 to 20% of patients coming into the ED require a psychiatric consult to appropriately triage the patient, and they generally have to wait hours, if not longer. So Dignity has it down to 9 minutes, where they get a consult from a psychiatrist, they appropriately triage the patient in 6 hours to get them onto home or transfer in-house or pass on to some other location, which is, to be frank, is incredibly fast. Okay, which is good. Now, I talked about our cloud, and what's very interesting about the cloud, which has turned out to be a big deal, is that since it's a common architecture which goes across all of the different locations we can connect to, we can actually take care of locations outside of the four walls of the customer organization. So Dignity, I think it's a $10 billion operation. They want to connect to a skilled nursing facility, or they want to connect to an unaffiliated hospital. Their problem, as big as they are, they don't own those places, and they don't have people managing those places. And so it turned out that our cloud was very, very important in making that happen. Here's six of our customers: Allina, Dignity, HCA, you may have heard of, is the largest for-profit healthcare system in the country. And here are the different sites that we're in of these different customers. And you can see that roughly, if I average all those, let's call it 50%. Their stroke networks, half of it goes within their system, and half of it goes to outside their system. And that turns out to be a big deal because that's what's allowing the whole delivery of care across a continuum. And that's the phrase, which is kind of the buzz phrase hitting healthcare today, is how do you provide care across the continuum? So why did that become a buzz phrase? It's because of what's going on in healthcare reform. Okay, healthcare reform, you know, is very much in full swing. And the key driver to healthcare reform is that providers are being paid differently. And the issue is that, you know, historically, a fee-for-service business where the more the provider does, the more the provider makes, is changing to where payment structures are putting quality as a metric as well, or the concept is it changes to pay for value. And that's making kind of seismic changes happening in the in the healthcare world. And then for telemedicine, there are other things like licensure, credentialing, privileging, and other legal regulatory barriers are actually coming down. I'm part of the American Telemedicine Association, which is kind of the biggest association dealing in this field. And it's almost monthly today, some barrier here is being knocked down. You know, reimbursement for telemedicine, improved ability to license and credential across state lines, et cetera. So those are really happening. And so it was just last week or a week before was the annual American Telemedicine Association meeting. And so I presented a couple of these slides where the interesting thing is that the membership is now up to 9,000, which is quite a bit more than it was even a few years ago. And there's continued growth in the institutional and corporate membership. And they did a study on some of these newer areas of telemedicine, tele-ICU, telestroke, online consultations. And these are the numbers they came up with in terms of the number of patients who were taken care of in this different way. So 125,000 strokes, 500,000 patients who are in the ICU are seen by a remote physician, 800,000 people have seen their primary care doc via a video thing. How many people, just out of curiosity, how many people in the audience have done that? Okay, so a few. Yeah, so it's interesting that that my company, In Touch, we have Anthem, and they're offering that as a service now. You know, unbeknownst to us, that's kind of, you know, I got a letter in the mail and says, if you want to see a primary care doc via video, you can. This is the ATA, again, had a big showroom floor, and these were the number of exhibitors in the floor. In 2005, there was about 100 exhibitors. This past year, there were about 280. And you can see the categories, too. They're getting increasingly, they're becoming increasingly focused on telemedicine. I'd say, for example, up here, take video conferencing back in 2005. Video conferencing, those companies, I think, were selling into telemedicine as one vertical of many verticals they were selling into. Down here, these companies are making a business in telemedicine. So I think the growth is very real. This right here is a slide on the investing into the field. So in 2011, there was about $1 billion of invested capital in digital health. In 2012, there's $1.4 billion. In 2013, there was about $2 billion. And then last year, there was $4.3 billion, which was as much as the last 3 years combined. So investment capital going into this area is obviously going up a lot as well. The other thing that's happening is that it's segmenting. The area segmenting to, you know, there's lots of different ways to perhaps draw the segmentation, but this is the way we drew it. There's acute care, telemedicine, and there's this kind of consumer-directed or direct-to-consumer, whatever you want to call it. It's the side where I might see a primary care physician from my home because I got a sore throat, okay? And then there's the outpatient setting here. And what's happening right now, we view ourselves as one of the top players here. And then there are other companies which are top players here. And what's happening right now, there's becoming a collision in the middle. Like, we are now, we never thought of these guys as competitors. We always thought of these guys as competitors. But now these guys are trying to come into here, and we are coming into here as well. And so it's actually making for some very interesting dynamics in the marketplace. And what the payers, the providers are all trying to figure out is how to take care of patients across this continuum, okay? In Touch, first decade of our existence, our world was that. Now it turns out that's not big enough because our customers are saying, we want to take care of patients out here in over here. So our company is evolving to where now we are becoming what's called an enterprise platform to be able to help our customers, which are the healthcare systems, provide care all the way across that continuum because they are now at risk on payment on that. It used to be if a person came in, got a procedure, was discharged, the hospital, the physician would bill for it and get paid, and then, okay, if the patient comes back again 2 weeks later, needs some kind of fixing, they leave, they bill again for it. That's going away. They don't get paid again for doing that. And so what the health systems are doing is trying to figure out how to get care to the patients they're responsible for in the lowest cost environment possible. So the hospital is obviously the highest cost place, and the home perhaps is the lowest cost place. So if you can do something at the home, do it at the home, not at the hospital. If you can do something in the clinic, do it at the clinic, not at the hospital. And this is kind of what's happening now in this area of telemedicine. I sit on the board of a hospital called Hoag, which is in Newport Beach. This is actually a Hoag slide. These things actually are how the management team of Hoag is being compensated. In other words, they have parts of their bonus tied to each of these different metrics. And I'll point out a couple of ones. Readmissions in 30 days. If they have a high readmission rate, they get docked. It used to be they'd make more money, and actually then the executive would make more money. Now they get docked. Bundles of care. These are also things which are then making the healthcare system think about how to take care of patients outside of their four walls to lower their costs such that it provides better care for the patient as well as lowers total cost. So what we are now doing, as I mentioned, we're using this cloud and we are extending outside from the acute center into the post-acute and community centers. And the types of applications we are moving down are things like this. Bundled payments, readmit reductions, high-risk pregnancies. So what do I mean by these things? And Shwadan, you can go ahead and beam into one of these things now. So a bundled payment is like, so we have a pilot going on in at Thomas Jefferson, for example. And there's a neurosurgery patient. Neurosurgery patients operated on, sent home. They're on a 90-day bundled payment. A 90-day bundled payment means all the care given to that patient for those 90 days, the hospital and physician get one fee for. So what are they doing now? They're sending home the patient. Uh-oh, did I turn you off? So go ahead and log in the other one if you can, Shwadan. So what they are doing is they are sending the patient home with a tablet like this. And so you got a 90-day period of time where the office, what would have been an office visit is now a home visit, where the physician, the physician sees the patient in their home on day 10, day 15, day 25, day 40, day 50, day 70, day 90, and then at the end of that, they're given a pre-packaged envelope to send the thing back. And so I was talking to the chairman of neurosurgery about this. He says they see about 800 patients a week in their office clinic. They think about a third of their patients would be useful for. So they can offload, they can reduce the number of office visits they need to deal with by a third, And then these patients actually also don't need to go in for the third. And if they see something funny, then obviously they'll have them come in afterwards. So those are the kinds of things which are now driving this telemedicine movement from the acute care setting and then heading all the way into the environment. So in summary here, you know, there's been seismic movements in industries over time, and they're going to continue in summer. Some are probably going to be coming here soon. I think during lunch today, I was talking with people about, you know, self-driving cars and how that's going to happen in impact society. You know, we've all read about, you know, Amazon drones delivering packages and stuff. I think one of the big movements which is going to happen in the coming decade is the virtualization of healthcare delivery. And I think if we do that right, we can in fact improve quality of care to everybody at a lower cost. So thank you very much.
All right. Fascinating. I told you, Yulin has good toys. Okay, so what I'm going to ask the panel to do is rather than have me go through the bios that are all in your program and stuff like that, I want to ask each of the panel to introduce themselves and talk about their experiences in this field. And then we'll come back and start into group discussions. Rita?
Well, I'm Rita Moya, and I have several hats that I wear. One is with BioIQ. I've been their chief strategist for number of years and watched the company grow. It's a local company. You're probably somewhat familiar with it. The CEO, Justin Belante, has presented here a number of times. But that company is in telehealth, but we never would have called it that when we started the company. We do a lot of data collection. And it's basically all done at the convenience of consumers, some of it remotely, but it's taking clinical data and getting it to the decision makers. And I think that's a lot of what any of these telehealth systems do. I've been involved in healthcare for a number of years. We'll leave it at that. But what will date me is when I went back to look at some presentations I'd given on telehealth. And one was from 1994 at the UC Davis Telemedicine Center, and I talked about the barriers, and those included the cost, because the technology was very expensive back then, and also the regulatory climate, the lack of reimbursement, the lack of acceptance by physicians, and there wasn't a lot of progress in that, really. I mean, the internet came along, and we thought that was going to be a sea change, but it's only been in the last 5 years, really, that we've seen, you know, that rapid ramp up, and I think that has a lot to do with people willing to pay. It's always about, it's not about who benefits in healthcare, it's about who pays, and now we have entities that are going at risk for whole populations, and they're willing to pay for what works. And through some of the pioneer efforts, like we've just heard about, we know that there are a lot of things that work. So as an investor, which is something I also do, we you know, look to visionaries, but we also look to markets. And I have spent quite a bit of time, you know, looking at population health as a market, telemedicine, telehealth within that, and the potential there is very, very exciting. The 441 million in 2013 is projected to grow to 4.5 billion by 2018. That's a very big ramp up. And there's also an international component to this. Globally, the market's growing at over 18% by 2020. That's an annual growth rate until 2020. As an investor, I got involved in this market early on in India with a company called HealthPoint, which also had some barriers. And I think, you know, as you look internationally at these technologies, it's not just the cost. There's many people that need access in very remote areas where there's very few doctors. But what you don't sometimes see are the cultural settings. And in the particular project in northern India, it was really just the acceptance of the population. We had to contend with the witch doctors in those communities that said, don't go to that, you know, terrible clinic where they're going to, you know, use a camera and you're going to look at a screen. And it was a really huge barrier. The only thing that saved those remote clinics in India was that we also put in water filtration systems. So the local people came there to get their fresh water. And gradually, they kind of got used to the technology, and it has survived. But I think, you know, as you look at investing, and particularly this growth internationally, where there are so many, you know, we have a shortage of maybe 45,000 primary care physicians, and certainly there's a need for all this technology here to provide greater access, particularly in rural areas. But when you look around the world, and I'm involved with a nonprofit here, Direct Relief, we work with some of the most impoverished populations in the world, and their access to doctors and medicines is, you know, it doesn't even compare. There are so few physicians in many of these countries. But you also then have to look at the acceptance of the technology and just the problems with using technology in remote rural areas. So I think, you know, as an investor, this market here in the U.S. is probably still one that holds the most potential. I think I'll stop at that and let my colleague Dean here pick it up.
Dean Hovey with DigiFit. I joined the company about 3 years ago. The company has been shipping products for about 4 years. And the focus really started in mobile apps. Actually, our first product was on iPod touches. And then when the iPhone came out, we moved to that. And they were really health and fitness apps with a specialty on heart rate monitoring. So that's where you strap something on your chest, you get the signal from your heart, it goes to your phone, creates a real-time chart, and people track it for either improving their performance as an athlete, or many are using it to keep track of their calories because they're trying to lose weight. So one of the challenges of being early is that you have to cobble together solutions. And so we got really good at connecting various sensors to phones to sort of serve the quantified self folks, because what we found, particularly in the people that were trying to lose weight or to back off of being a type 2 diabetic or something, they actually wanted a number of devices connected together. So they used the heart rate strap for caloric burn. They had a scale that they could connect to the internet that would, every time they step on it, would load it up to the cloud. They were putting these Fitbits on to count their steps. They had blood pressure cuffs. And they had other apps that had various specialties, and they sort of put together a program that actually helped them lose weight. I mean, we have people writing in that said, I lost 70 pounds, I lost 50 pounds, I lost 120 pounds. And as we talked to them, we recognized that these were really health pioneers of sorts, where they were solving their own dilemmas with technology. We created a cloud, we keep all this information together, and we could actually see people improving their health. This came at the same time that we're now in this cost reduction mode and trying to figure out how do we take care of people less expensively. Well, these pioneers sort of figured out the way, and what we've done is said, there's actually plans that we can put together that integrate these devices that follow what we call their story arc, what it is that they want to accomplish. They get discharged from the hospital, they have heart surgery, they've got a 90-day connection, the doctor talks to them every once in a while, but what happens when you're not talking to the doc? What data would be important to be paying attention to? How do I learn the new habits of my life that talk differently about how much exercise should I do? What kinds of food should I be eating? What should my weight be? should I be alarmed if I go up 6 pounds overnight? Those kinds of things. So we can create that experience design, integrate the sensors and the software, and also connect that data to the health systems so that the doctor not only can look at them physically, but can also look at the chart and know what they've been doing or not doing for the last week. And so that's the really exciting thing, because this can happen in the home. The data is being collected, and you can actually see where maybe the patient's done 8 of the 10 things really well, and those other 2 is what the doctor or the nurse practitioner needs to have the conversation around to fix them. We have people that have had kidney failure, and now they want to do home dialysis. Well, that's a whole other thing to learn about the equipment, the sterilization, the process that they have to go through on a daily basis, and it, you know, the documentation's about that thick. But if you can create something that's a mobile experience, that you go step by step and start creating habits about hand washing, sterilization, eating, monitoring your fluids in a reasonable way, you can dramatically, again, reduce the cost and intervention of the real humans, but provide the data so that if there is an intervention that's required, that happens. So it's an extension of really what we're talking about into the home.
Melinda?
Thank you. So here's mine. And mine has a little red line that is now very long, and that means I have not gotten up and taken my steps. It's very irritating by the end of the day, but tells me I better get going. So I'm Melinda Stavely, and I'm the Vice President at Cottage Rehabilitation Hospital. I'm also the VP that oversees therapy services in all of our sites for Cottage Health. We became part of Cottage Health 7 years ago. Prior to that, we were a rehabilitation institute at Santa Barbara and have been in this community now almost 60 years. I've been in the field for 35, began as a registered nurse in physical medicine and rehabilitation. When the average length of stay at that time was 4.5 months. The average length of stay now in a rehabilitation hospital or unit is 14 days nationally. And that's from the most benign, if any stroke can be called benign, or hip fracture, to the most complicated spinal cord injury and or brain injury. So we have much less time now in which to work with face-to-face the experts, the therapists, the physicians, the nurses. And I do want to extend what we're talking about today to all practitioners, not just physicians, because I think it's important that one of the things that telehealth allows us to do is to actually incorporate many, many more practitioners under the guidance of physicians. A very important piece of this, I think. So the other thing that's interesting in the research that I did in looking at articles that are being published, and you said something like 800,000. Well, I went to one small journal, the Association of Rehabilitation Nursing. I also went to the APTA, American Physical Therapy Association journal, and found in just 1 year, 8 pages of articles on telehealth, virtual reality, also being incorporated into this process. So, in one of the articles, not written by a nurse, it was said that the most receptive group of people to this new technology is, in fact, nurses, because they see the opportunity to extend the expertise to a much greater, a much larger group of people in post-acute care. And I think post-acute care is really the future of all of this. And the feds, Center for Medicare and Medicaid, call post-acute care rehabilitation, what we do at Cottage Rehabilitation Hospital, inpatient, SNFs, skilled nursing facilities, home health, hospice and long-term care acute care hospitals. So there's various levels of care, and I think you're in all of them, InTouch Health is, and others. A couple of things that I wanted to mention that are going on in Cottage Health, and one thing that hasn't been mentioned is video remote interpreting. So we have 12 interpreters in our four hospital system, and obviously that's not enough. And those folks don't know 200 languages. So if a recent patient that we had from Kuwait, for example, with very little English, we actually used the video remote interpreting. And that's through an iPad, through Skyping, and there, through the service that you access, is the interpreter who can, in fact, with the physician or with the nurse, help get the information exchanged, understood, and the person knowing what they're supposed to do. Another use that we haven't mentioned, it came to me from a minister the other day who had come to visit and do advanced care planning with a patient in Santa Barbara Cottage Hospital. And she needed to use the interpreter and, in fact, found it preferable to use the video interpreting service because there was not another human being in the room to whom she had to pay attention. That physical presence and to make sure and to look at and go back and forth. Her attention, this minister, was solely on the patient. And the patient also remarked that it was a very private experience. So somehow, the person, through the iPad, remotely interpreting, did not intrude in the same way that the actual human interpreter does. So a very interesting experience that we have. We also use a lot of this process. I've actually been assessed through your outfit, because if we do that, we in Cottage Health get $250 back on our benefits, because we are promoting health among our employees. So another example of how this is used. Our speech-language pathologists use it a great deal. So Brain HQ, perhaps some of you are familiar with, is a internet program that speech-language pathologists can use with their patients. These are people post-stroke or post-brain injury, traumatic brain injury often. They use it one-on-one together in therapy, either as inpatients or then in the Keck Center for Outpatient Services. However, they then send people home with instructions to use the Brain HQ themselves with an iPad, which we have a foundation, fortunately, which allows us to help folks purchase these iPads if they need them and can't. And then the therapist can hook in also and monitor the work that the patient is doing individually and independently to make sure that they're on track. So in essence, we are beginning to see an ability to provide expertise to a much larger volume of people and stay in touch with them. Cottage is also now about to embark with the tele-stroke program with InTouch Health. And by July 1st or so, I am hearing, if that's still on target, that's what you've heard, there will be the little guy. And I have to tell you why I call the robot the little guy, and that's because he was alpha tested at Rehabilitation Institute at Santa Barbara in 2002 in our gym. And I want you to know that I'm personally responsible for having taught the little guy about personal space. Because I walked into the gym one day when the little guy was roaming around and approaching patients and the therapist, etc. And all of a sudden, he came over to me and he was right here. And I said, okay, back him off. And we talked about personal space. So there are some things that the little guy had to be taught about human interaction that's very important. Anything you want to say about that?
Melinda, we started in the incubator. We started in the incubator down on Gutierrez Street, and you know, it was at a point in time when you really didn't know if the internet was going to be able to carry this kind of a control ability at any distance at all. So we met with Melinda. This is in 2002, and said, "Hey, is it okay if we alpha test this in your place?" And it was about, what, 8 blocks down the road then. So we took what Melinda's calling the little guy, and we stuck it in the rehab center, and several of the physical therapists worked with us where we could watch a patient, like watch a gait, for example, in doing physical therapy, and we'd watch it from our office in Gutierrez in order to do that. And, you know, at the time, it was incredibly exciting. So I'm always grateful to Melinda for
that.
We
had such fun. It was wonderful.
I like it that you call it the little guy. At 5'2", I'm looking at that, and I like it. It's not the little guy to me at all. So let me ask you, you know, for anything to become ubiquitous in our society, we need technology. In our medical society, we need technology. We need reimbursement. We need the caregiver acceptance, and we need patient acceptance, okay? And technology is moving pretty fast, and we're seeing, you know, enough movement on the reimbursement side and some incentives there. I don't think we're quite there yet. But maybe each of you could talk a little bit about not only the promise, but the barriers you see to completing the cycle.
I've got some real-world experience with several hospital systems, and we're actually partnering with a group called Spring Network, who help hospital organizations basically re-engineer their service delivery based upon some of these new ACA, ACO models. And so the way in which you deliver care and the way you have care teams is a completely different what they call motion than what a lot of the doctors and nurses are used to. And so even if you have great technology, the systems have their own habits. Mm. And we're actually in the habit changing business with our technology, which allows you to take little steps to learn the new way to do. So you actually have to partner with a social technical change in order to make this work. So it's a whole different pricing model, care support model, teamwork model that needs to go in. Because if you just show up with the technology, a lot of the docs are busy. They've done it this way for a long time. The whole industry is set on research, documented, this is the way we do things. And to change that cycle is not easy.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of folks threatened, don't you, by any kind of change. I've been doing it this way. I want to continue to do it this way. I know what's the best way. So I think that's just human. And I think there's some of that still in existence. I think because there isn't complete alignment yet between the payment models and the delivery, we've got certainly the hospital systems still have one foot in fee for service and want to milk every penny there is possible out of fee-for-service, and another foot on the boat that's taking off for accountable care. I think population health and health looking, refocusing on health of the whole community as opposed to health of a sick person coming into four walls is really shifting more some places than other places, but I think until we make that complete shift, and that's the cloud ability. Santa Barbara Neighborhood Clinics, I serve on the board of, medical home, it's a medical home for the folks that they serve. That spoke into the hospital that we anticipate and have the right care at the right place and don't bring folks to the hospital that don't need to be there. So when we really look at just take Santa Barbara. How is Santa Barbara going to deliver maximum health care to the most people to keep us as healthy as possible? And I think all of these technologies really give us the opportunity to do that. The barrier is each of us getting over the concern that we're going to get left by the wayside because something else is going to come along and do it better. So the change management to encourage people to see that I can do it differently and have my role and feel rewarded and use my expertise. When DRGs, anybody know what that is? Diagnostic related groups, that's prospective payment, came into play in hospitals, and then it about 10 years later came into the rehabilitation setting. We have CMGs, case mix groups. I'm sitting around the table with my team, and we're trying to figure out how we're going to deliver the care with the reduced payment and the reduced number of days. And one woman looked at me, very, very talented, well-meaning therapist, and said, "I can't do that. How can I do that? I know so much more that I can do for these people," and put her head down on the table and cried. And I thought, well, my dear, you're going to just need to move on because you need to retool. You need to figure out a different way for your expertise to be utilized. And I think that's really where we are now, is my kids aren't going to have this problem because they've been using technology since they were 3 years old, right? 5 years old, 10 years old, whatever, kids today. So we're in this transition period, I think.
I guess I don't see it as much of a transition because of BioIQ being in the population health business now for almost 10 years. And as a vendor to large employers and promoting wellness within that employee population, we've had to deal with engagement and convenience of the consumer so that you can enhance engagement. And that's really what population health is all about, getting everyone engaged so that you can collect the optimum amount of data that you can then manage and put into analytics engines and you know, come up with the risk population that you need to manage and the others that just need to maintain their health. I think we all know kind of, you know, what's going on when entities are taking on risk of whole populations. They have to deal with everyone. And what is the selling point to me of telehealth is it's convenience for the consumer, and convenience drives engagement. I mean, it drives engagement in all these other services that we've become so used to using. You know, even look at cable television and then look at Netflix and Hulu and all these other platforms that have come in and how people have adopted to them. People my age, you know, it's do we watch it on Hulu tonight or do we look at Netflix? I mean, everyone is getting very comfortable with multiple platforms, but they want the convenience of being able to reach out and do things simply and get what they want. And usually in their home, that's the number one preference. So I think it's happening in so many parts of our lives that if we think about all of these services as bringing convenience, you're going to see very rapid push from the consumer to adopt to some of these technologies within the provider community. And a new Harris poll that just came out, 64% of the population, which was a real representative poll of the United States, 64% of the adults would like to use telehealth for convenience. That was the number one driver. And so I think as you move more into population health, taking risk for populations, you've got to figure out engagement, and engagement is tied to convenience. At least that's been our experience at BioIQ. If we can make biometric testing so convenient for people, they're not going to come up with all the excuses of why not to do it, and reaching out to them also in their homes and all of those things that bring that convenience, it really drives the engagement, which is how you keep people healthy when they're engaged in their own health.
Okay, but let me ask you then, what about the disparity across the system? Now, you're saying, oh, people want convenience in their home. And I know that DigiFit and other devices like that, while they have all the promise of being able to capture information, of giving us more, it's still a matter of, do you get people to really use them and use them consistently? The studies still show that, what, one-third to one-half of people that have a DigiFit-type device may stop using it within 6 months because the feedback that they get from it doesn't necessarily meet their expectations. When you get into those three segments of care that you're talking about, Yulin, obviously we can improve care across all of them if we have data that isn't disparate between, you know, groups. How much is that going to affect our movement towards the future?
I think it's going to affect the movement a lot. And what you actually hit on there, Kathy, is I think a really important point, is that telehealth enables a gathering of data which happens naturally. You know, if you're taking care of a patient in person, and they basically, then you do everything you're going to do, and then you go and you write things later, it's a secondary step to do that. So in our case, you know, as I mentioned, we do a lot of strokes. Mm-hmm. The way we have a workflow set up is that actually we automatically record when the patient comes in the door, when the physician is paged, when the physician logs on, what the actual, there's a workflow the physician goes through, what the physician does with the patient, and then a note is automatically documented and is done. So my point is, and so we're gonna get like 75,000 of those this year. I don't know the answer, but I think the biggest healthcare systems in the country, Mayo Clinic or Cleveland Clinic, probably do a couple thousand strokes for the year. So we're not a big company. We're going to outstrip them by almost 40x, okay? And we're going to get all that data. And so I use that as an example, that telehealth actually facilitates the natural gathering of data, which then you can run analytics on, which then you can use to feed back to do best practices and improve things on a much more rapid pace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, and Melinda, you and I talked about, you know, some of this earlier, is how could this be used to create new tiers within the healthcare system, more use of physician assistants or data readers, people that could be looking at data before handing a patient off. Mm-hmm. So you want to talk a little bit more about that?
So we talked before. Are you all familiar, I'm sure you are, with Daniel Kraft and Singularity University up north of the state? I heard him speak a couple, three, 4 weeks ago, and he was... Essentially, he introduced himself, first of all, as a sprinter, and you knew within about 6 minutes of his talking that he was indeed a sprinter, because you really had to run fast to keep up with him. So he presented about 25 devices that actually can monitor, can be sent home with patients, monitor them, and send information back to the home healthcare agency, to the hospital, to the wherever. most of which are not being used very many places, not being adopted and utilized yet. Well, why is that? So one of the things that I question, and I think we need to pay more attention to, is human behavior. So 5% of our health is actually impacted by medical care. The other 95% of our health is my choice, your choice. What I eat, how much exercise I do, whether I drink enough water, whether I get enough rest, all those things we all know. How many of us really do them? Even though we know, because we'd rather go to the doctor and have them give us some kind of medicine or some kind of intervention. So I think in terms of population management and data, until we figure out a way that that data is really going to impact my behavior, we still are going to have this gap.
That's a really good point. Go ahead, Dave.
One clarification, DigiFit and Fitbit are two different companies.
No, I do know that. I mean,
we've talked about Apple Watches
and everything. Yeah.
But I think the maybe I can draw some analogies, because you're absolutely right about the behavior. But if somebody has had a heart attack and heart surgery, and what's really motivating them is they really do want to get back on the tennis court, then what you need to design is that experience that gets them from that heart attack back to the tennis court. And you need to select those things that they need to pay attention to in order to get there. So then you pick the sensor that you need to give them the information and the feedback to make those new habits and direction. So yes, people will get a Fitbit. They'll use it for 30, 60, 90 days, sometimes 6 months. And either you then become addicted to the data and you stick with it, or you say, okay, been there, done that. I know what 10,000 steps means. In a normal day, I only do 3,000 or 4,000, so I really have to make the extra effort. I want to get 10 done. And you don't get in your car and sit there and look at the dashboard, right? I mean, the dashboard is helpful for you to get from here to there, but it's the experience of the driving and getting to the destination that counts. So that's the perspective that we need to apply, is understanding the person's goal, designing the experience, and giving the monitoring to give them the feedback to know that they're doing the right things and making progress.
So in the Star Trek Federation or something, when we can, it looks like, with technology, begin to design devices that will be comfortable for people to wear, that will collect data, that will analyze data, that will have algorithms, that will send a trigger report. So in other words, if everything's fine, you may be looking at the dashboard, but you're not looking at all the instruments and reading them all and trying to interpret them. But if the alarm goes off, somebody gets a message. But the other thing is, what's going to drive us to truly begin to integrate all the data that you can collect from DigiFit, that can be available in an acute situation when the little guy, big guy, whatever he is, and I presume smaller versions of the little guy, are more readily available. I mean, what's that going to take?
I think that's the trillion-dollar question, or 100 billion, or whatever the right number is. I think that the human behavior is trying to stop people from smoking or drinking too much and stuff like that. We've been challenged with that for decades. So I think the one more thing added on top of your listing is then you got that motivation component, which is so key. What's interesting, so how is InTouch dealing with that problem? Because that is what providers are trying to do. They're trying to figure out how to incentivize providers and payers. They're trying to incentivize how to get people to stay healthy as they're doing population health management. But for a company like InTouch, what's interesting is people aren't that willing to pay for that yet, because there isn't a known way to do it. And so So a company can't go in and say, here's your ROI if you do this, because it's not very well proven. So what we have to do, as one example, is we have to make our money on the acute care side of taking sick people to a better state, which is there is a business model on that today, and then supply we want our customers to embrace us for larger things, and then supply them with these ability to pilot and on other things, while that's being figured out.
Okay.
And I think it's a lot of social media-ish kind of stuff is part of the answer.
Probably so. Okay, we're going to open up to questions. So if those of you in the audience would like to ask a question, raise your hand. We'll bring a microphone to you. Okay, let's start up here.
I just had a question about, as you try to bring the robotics or telemedicine into the home and into these other settings, it seems like being able to gather data through otoscopes and all the ports and things that you showed in the robot will be really important. So where is the state of that in terms of what you can plug into an iPad and iPhone and things like that?
That one, in terms of like bringing something like that into the home, actually, for example, I have one in my mom's home. Because it's just a volume cost thing. It's actually as simple as that. I think it's going to follow the pathway of like the cell phones, right? The cell phones were first given to first responders and people who, physicians on call. Then now, 10-year-old, preteens have their cell phone because the volume drove the price down, which then allowed a different category of people to buy, drives the volume, drives the price down. I think it's going to go through that kind of a process. So, I mean, the next one for us, the big one, is actually SNFs, skilled nursing facilities, because you're leveraging a lot of people using a single tool, but it's a lower cost center than like a hospital. And then I think, it's probably after that kind of thing into the home.
Okay.
I may be in a minority. I actually enjoyed my colonoscopy because they said,
okay,
after it was done, and I even didn't know it was done, they said, you're fine, go on home, you have someone to drive you home. But then, I've had MRIs, I've had blood tests, and they tell me, well, we'll get these results to you in 3 days. Well, in the new healthcare, I'm going to be a demanding consumer and say, what do you mean in 3 days? How about right now? Okay? You did the test. You see the results right there. Is there a place for InTouch to say on-demand results delivery, feeding evidence-based medicine, and all the rest of the stuff?
Yeah, so that's a great point, and I think we work on the interaction side a lot, and you're asking for like different tests. I actually saw a little thing about the woman who's the woman billionaire who can do a blood test with a couple of drops instead of many test tubes. Mm-hmm. So I think your point is well taken, that when people can figure out fast, reliable, convenient result, like BioIQ kind of stuff, then people will adopt it.
Well, the blood test, yeah. Right there, there's still a lag time. Okay.
Well, it doesn't have to be. In a lot of BioIQ's corporate clients, nurses go on site, they test the blood, they get the results. And actually, before the person leaves, if they have some risk factors, they're connected to an intervention, be it coaching, we can send the data to their physician. It's about making the connections for the next step. It's not just knowing what those results are, but being able to interpret them and then know what your next step is. So I think pharmacies are going to be in a great position to do that, and we're putting together a network of pharmacies, so you're going to be able to go into the pharmacy and do exactly what you're talking about.
Can you turn the response time from hours, days, or hours, to minutes and seconds.
For certain tests. There are some very new advanced technologies. The technology we were using at HealthPoint in India was one of those diagnostic machines that could diagnose 20 some diseases with one drop of blood. Isn't FDA approved here because it wasn't very accurate. But those technologies are advancing, and I think it's not going to be years and years. I think it's going to be in, the threshold is probably 5 years.
Can you get an MRI readout to the patient in 5 minutes?
Mm. Okay. So okay. I think that really requires the radiologist, yeah, right? Yeah. So that's the key.
Yeah, okay.
The radiologist within touch, can you do it in 5 minutes, do you think?
We don't do that today.
No. We have a couple more questions. Let's go to Leslie first, and then we'll come to David. Okay.
So I've, been going to these forums, and last month, the head of AARP that looks at innovative technologies and what we're doing with Fitbits, and also a lot of articles in The Economist talk about what is really the challenge with these long-term, very expensive disease states, such as diabetes, and I would say cardiovascular disease. And the biggest challenge that they keep honing in on is that the average patient is elderly. They're not comfortable with reading data. They're not comfortable with new technologies. They resent a Fitbit bought by their children. So if you read, there's a couple of articles in the last 1 year in The Economist talking about who is buying the technology. And I'll just say, my mother, who's 80, got a Fitbit from me, and she hates me for it because she thinks I am trying to monitor her life. But I think that that's a big picture. I think that the long-term residual diseases that have no end of control that are going to increase our, expenditure are things like diabetes and cardiovascular disease, where you're looking at elderly folks who would probably really love a card rather than a Fitbit. So I think that it's more of a socioeconomic and, probably a geriatric issue, that if we're really trying to push down the cost of healthcare, it presents itself in a very different way than a lot of people are saying. It's great that we get this data, but if the person that's costing us the most amount, which is probably your diabetic, who is 75 to 85, how are you convincing these people to do any of these things? They resent most technologies, so it's, but I think that the biggest growing population of expensive healthcare is elderly people.
It probably is. Melinda, you probably have some perspective on that.
Well, what you're saying reminds me a little bit of my grandmother, who died at 98 with all of her own teeth, incredibly healthy. I hope I have her genetics. Saying to me, and this is 24 or 5 years ago, Melinda, dear, don't call your friend. Go see them. Well, texting, whatever. My point being here is that we are in transition. We have a generation of people who are, to some degree, uncomfortable. But I think as the generations roll over, if you will, and I fade out and my children come into the fore, there are going to be fewer and fewer people uncomfortable with all of this. I will tell you, we have internet throughout Cottage Rehabilitation Hospital. I can't think of a patient of any age in the last probably 3-4 years who hasn't come in with an iPad or an iPhone and wants to make very sure that they can be on that device connected to whomever. So I think it's more and more. I wanted to raise and just find out, how many of you have read Atul Gawande?
Of course.
Lots of people. He has, his newest article is in the May 11th New Yorker. He writes for the New Yorker as well as his book, newest book being Mortal. But this article, I think, is relevant here because it's about waste in healthcare. And one of my questions that I wanted to raise is, the more access that we give all of us, the more we want. And that concerns me because we are doing a lot of tests, we are giving a lot of medicines that really are a waste. And how are we going to balance this growing access for more and more people to more and more esoteric interventions, if you will, with the fact that they don't do us any good and they actually waste a lot? Pardon?
Yeah, so Melinda, that's an excellent point. And so the ATA, American Telemedicine Association, has been kind of lobbying for, one of the things they do is lobby, right? They lobby for, and for 10 years they lobbied for just reimbursement for telemedicine. And they and basically the argument was, you know, a telemedical visit is as good as an in-person visit, so you should reimburse the same way. And they got nowhere. And to be frank, I actually think it's kind of right they got nowhere, in the sense that so what would happen is it would go to Congress, it would go to the Congressional Budget Office. The Congressional Budget Office would say, hey, this is going to increase utilization by X amount, and therefore it's going to increase. So they were very, very, very concerned about opening the floodgates for exactly that reason. Mm-hmm. Now what's happening is, and I think it's the right way, is instead of just trying to take the fee-for-service basis methodology, you just open it up and just reimburse for easier and easier access to do it, which, you know, you can make an argument it's good in some sense, but you can also make an argument it's going to drive costs up through the roof. If you shift into a pay-for-value strategy and you leave it on the shoulders of the provider of how do you most cost-effectively deliver the most value, and then a telemedicine approach is what's used there, that's the right way for it to go.
I mean, that, okay, moderator, but still, I've always said that it drives me crazy that we have so many physicians that will overprescribe antibiotics and other just minor things just because it's much easier to give your patient what they want if they want to utilize the healthcare. And again, when it comes back to paying for value and you've got data, and you get data that says, no, that is not a good outcome, and so you better prove why you do it. We have two questions I know in the audience, so Bob, would you mind if we go to David first and we're going to come to you? I think you have a question, right? Okay. David, let's go to you. Need a microphone?
So very interesting discussion. And Yulin, I want to start with you and pick up a little bit to drill down on where Kathy kind of opened up the panel. And I thought Melinda gave an initial response. And I want to just dive a little deeper on driving that value and how you picked up on the stroke element where you wanted to add more value. Picking up on Kathy's comment about barriers. When talking about innovation and disruptive technology and driving adoption, I'm curious specifically, what incumbent constituencies are you up against specifically that want to protect the status quo?
Yeah, so I'll try to make the answer not too long, because it could be I could write a dissertation on this. So how does a stroke network work, okay? There's a hub hospital with the specialties. They put telemedicine out and outline smaller hospitals which don't have the specialties, and the idea is that when a stroke patient comes into the spoke hospital, has a potential stroke, they contact the hub hospital who beams in and takes care of the patient. First problem. The spoke hospital goes, hey, you're not here to help me, you're here to take away all my patients, okay? So we had to prove that it turns out 70-80% of the patients actually stay in the outlying hospital. Second problem, the neurologist does the consult, But the economics are gained by the neurosurgeon or the interventional neurosurgeon, because what happens is if the patient is transferred into the hub hospital, there is a good potential that it's an interventional procedure, which is a high dollar reimbursement to the hospital and the interventionalist, but the neurologist is doing the work to do it. Neurologists, the telemedicine isn't reimbursing, as we just discussed. Neurologists saying, hey, I'm not gonna do it if I don't get paid anything. We had to work out the problem. The hospital had to pay the neurologist an additional on-call fee in order to do that, okay? Now, you go back several years to when we started, you have potential violation of anti-kickback and anti-Stark laws, because the hub hospital is buying the equipment, putting in the spoke hospital. There is an argument that it's inducing referrals by placing it out there, and especially the for-profit hospitals had to be very concerned about that. The non-profit hospitals could state it's under their mission, which is a true statement, to provide higher quality care. And at that point in time, every time we deployed it, the hospitals had to get outside counsel to actually overcome an anti-kickback, anti-Stark violation ruling, so that if they were ever challenged by the OIG, this would happen. So that's just kind of the beginning of the things we had to work through to get through. What's happened, though, things have advanced from there. So, for example, the OIG has ruled that telestroke programs do not violate any kickback and Stark laws, but that's only been in the last couple of years. So, and each one of these has a story like that. And that goes back to the barrier question very early on. You know, I've been involved in two things, surgical robots and this. Kathy was right. When surgical robots started, people thought it was kind of stupid. I mean, it was a little bit ludicrous. I don't want a robot operating on anything. But the only person we had to convince was the doc, the surgeon. Then the surgeon carried the rest of the way. You only had to convince one or two people in the hospital. When you try to get a telemedicine program going, now you're into dozens of people and perhaps hundreds of people to convince to move forward. And that actually is what I underestimated in starting. I thought this was going to go faster than it has. Fortunately, it's gone good enough. And so that's been the challenge, is the systemic change that had to happen for us to get going. But you know, the good news is the systemic change is accelerating.
Systemic change is what you specialize in, by the way. Yeah.
And you have to back up to... what are the entities that are now taking risk for those patients that end up in the acute stroke centers? So you go back to who are the entities that are paying for that care. It may be an employer that is trying to manage their population. It can be an ACO, Accountable Care Organization, that has taken on risk through a health plan. But you start aligning the incentives so it's in everybody's best interest to not have that person present with that stroke in the first place. And then if they do, to treat them in the most cost-effective and most evidence-supported way. And so I think that's what we're seeing, and that's one of the changes that's really driving a lot of the acceptance now. We've aligned those incentives so it's in the best interest of the different payers, you know, along the continuum of care. And where we'll really win is when that consumer is part of that alignment and wants to stay healthy, because they don't want to be in that situation. And there are incentives now for rewarding consumers for health, healthy behaviors. And I think there's some good results coming out of that. So it's the trends are slow to develop, but they are coming. And the accountable care organizations, the assuming of risk by these provider entities is really making a difference. Would you agree?
Yes.
Do we have one more question? That's it. Okay, do you have a microphone? There.
Rita, this question is for you or for Dean. So since the majority of medical devices aren't approved by the FDA, and now we're collecting large data sets, have there been any barriers to physicians' willingness to use the data that are coming out of these? And we're just kind of looking at as we shift from, you know, diagnosis to procedure and, you know, things like telehealth, being able to leverage the data that people are collecting at home?
Well, there are actually a lot of devices that are getting through FDA now. There's several levels of FDA that make it easier or harder to get through. I think a lot of the people say, well, Fitbit is an accurate steps compared to this or to that, but it's really a relative thing. It's to help you understand how much you need to do in order to get to your goal, and that's relative. So they will be very concerned if they're trying to do heart rate variability that the device is accurate, but if you're just saying, hey, I'm out running and I'm keeping my heart rate below 140, that's going to be good enough. So there's an awful lot of good enough in general health and wellness. It's when it really is down to some critical life or death situations that you've got to have a really accurate device. So, but that's moving really fast. So every day we're seeing new, you know, smart Bluetooth technology linked up to iPads and phones and things that are doing a great job.
So I think we have time for one more question. Do you have the microphone?
Yeah. So picking up on that, what are the implications for malpractice insurance? And also, what are the implications in terms of the prevention of the passage of the passing on of contagious diseases when somebody can, instead of going into the office or going into the emergency room if they've got the flu, they can take care of it from their home instead of exposing other people?
I can start. So with regards to malpractice, you know, it's interesting because actually one of the things I didn't mention yet is, so InTouch is actually moving into also being a provider as well, where we're contracting with physicians. So we actually are have done a lot of homework around malpractice for telemedicine specifically, and the answer is it actually varies. Some of the payers, insurance providers, will just say, oh yeah, that's fine. Because the physician has a check in terms of their malpractice insurance. Some insurance agents will say, well, there's a little premium. And then some insurance providers say, you can't use us anymore, you gotta go somewhere else. But I think that's a small minority, okay? Now, you know, and if I also tie back to the previous question too, you know, so we're FDA class 2 cleared. And one thing is the FDA is not an overly onerous thing if you know what you're doing. So I think the people who've never done it before, it looks like a huge thing, but it's just a process that you can get through if you decide to do it and get some help to do that. And I think therefore it's I think the other thing which is happening is the FDA, for a long time, and we've been watching this and interacting with it the whole time, their position in telehealth was very, very fuzzy, and it's becoming clearer and clearer. And it's going to become clearer and clearer because it's going to become more and more mainstream. And so I don't think you can ignore the FDA in the telehealth space. I forgot your second question. While I was talking, I was trying to remember the... Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah, yeah. So, yeah, it eliminates that. Right? I mean, if you're at home, you're not going to get anyone in the hospital sick. So... Yeah, I think it's a natural barrier, right?
And my experience is most doctors do not want to see the full 24/7 data stream of their patients. What they are interested in is setting some boundaries and fences, and if something starts to be outside of those, then set up some alerts. But they don't want to see that because then they could potentially be liable for that whole thing. You mean you didn't see that one blip at 2:23 a.m.? So we're working through that right now, but there's an awful lot you can do to help people on that behavior problem that is not data risky in that sense.
Okay, so I think we've come to the end of the evening, and I think that we all see a much brighter future in our health. And you want to make one final comment, Molly?
I do. I just would like to, there's these cards on the table. In October 4th, this is a save the date, Skip Rizzo, who is the director for virtual reality at USC in their innovative department, is going to be speaking here in Santa Barbara. and it might be of interest to all of you. Cottage Rehabilitation Hospital Foundation sponsors this event each year, Empowerment Through Medical Rehabilitation. He's going to be talking about the use of virtual reality in the rehabilitation field and with his use of it with PTSD. So both those populations.
Fabulous. Okay. We thank you all for coming, and let's give our panel a great round of applause. Thank you.